Good morning. My name is Gigi Gronvall, and I'm a senior associate at the Center for Biosecurity. This panel will focus on the world's most important instruments for health and health security, the Biological Weapons Convention, and the International Health Regulations. These treaties are pretty distinct animals, but over the years they have developed some common purposes and complementary goals. And the panelists have been asked to address what they consider to be the biggest successes in the implementation of these treaties and the priorities going forward. So basically, what's working and what's next. So before introducing the panelists, however, I wanted to give everyone a little bit of background so we're all on the same page about the agreements we're talking about. So the Biological Weapons Convention was the first international treaty to ban an entire class of weapons when it entered into force in 1975, and it upholds a moral norm that is still very strong. There is no nation that brags about their biological weapons programs. However, it has been blatantly disregarded in the past by the Soviet Union, Iraq, and South Africa. This has led to attempts to create a verification regime and a protocol to the treaty was negotiated between 1995 and 2001, but it was rejected in 2001. Many experts maintain that the substantial differences between the nuclear and biological weapons process makes true verification impossible for biological weapons. The BWC itself is very much in force still in spite of that the protocol. And in 2002, the states parties agreed to hold a series of annual meetings and that focus on BWC implementation. So there is an expert meeting and a states party meetings, and that has been the case for the last since 2001. The U.S. is a signatory to the BWC, and it participates in the review conferences as well as the expert group meetings. The International Health Regulations has a little bit of a longer history. There has been some form of the IHR for going back 150 plus years, intended to minimize disruption of trade even in the event of a disease emergency. Now with a new version agreed upon in 2005, it is increasingly looked to as a tool to increase transparency about disease outbreaks among nations. It requires countries to notify the World Health Organization, or WHO, of all events that constitute, quote, a public health emergency of international concern. The nations also agree to respond to requests for verification of information regarding public health risks. Okay, so now I'm going to introduce our panel. I'm going to introduce everybody, and then we are going to have remarks from each, and then we will have moderated discussion and then questions. So first, we will hear from Piers Millett, who has traveled to be here from Geneva. He is the deputy head of the Biological Weapons Convention Implementation Support Unit, or ISU, which is part of the United Nations Office of Disarmament Affairs. The ISU serves as the secretariat of the BWC meetings, but does so much more in addition, including interacting with other intergovernmental agencies and acting as a clearinghouse for information. Piers has been expanding their role and picking up the pace there since 2001. Next, we will hear from Chris Park, who is director of the Biological Policy Staff in the Bureau of International Security and Nonproliferation at the State Department. In his position, he coordinates the department's efforts under the National Strategy for Countering Biological Threats, which, as Ben mentioned, there are copies of outside, and serves as the state's ex officio member of the NSABB, so he is fluent about the dual use issue for biology. Before this, he was the senior advisor for bioterrorism for the Chemical Weapons Convention in The Hague. And then finally, we will hear from Keiji Fukuda, who is the Assistant Director General for Health, Security, and Environment at the World Health Organization in Geneva. Besides his leadership on the IHRs, he has helped to manage the H1N1 pandemic, is deeply involved in the intergovernmental discussions about the sharing of influenza viruses. And prior to moving to Geneva, he was chief of the epidemiology unit in the influenza branch at the CDC. And to my knowledge, he's the only one of us here who has been profiled in the New York Times. So with that, Piers.
Well, good morning, everyone. Thanks very much for the nice introduction. I'm going to keep my comments as brief as possible because I'm interested in having a discussion. And thank you very much, therefore, for knocking a few things out that I would have said. So luckily it wasn't so much so I can actually still have some comments. I should start out by pointing out that what I'm going to say are my own opinions and don't necessarily reflect those of either the treaty, the states parties, or the UN or the Office for Disarmament Affairs. That's not necessarily, and they're certainly my own opinions. BWC itself is a short treaty. It's only 4 pages long. You can fit it on two sides of a sheet of paper if you really try. You're all really busy people, so I'm going to try and summarize it for you in 4 sentences. Do not make or acquire biological weapons, second sentence. Do not allow anyone else or encourage anyone else to acquire those weapons. Got to take national measures to prevent and prohibit the development of those weapons. And finally, to do all of that in such a way that enables the peaceful use of biology to do all the great things that we will certainly be hearing about throughout the day. It's not a UN treaty. It's run by 3 countries. As a product of the Cold War, you will not be surprised to hear that the first 2 countries are the US and now Russia. The UK is also on the list. It has a long history of looking at the issue of biological weapons. The treaty currently has 163 members, another 13 that have signed up to it. So they've made the political statement that they're bound by its terms, but haven't actually passed a law to make that binding yet. So it's pretty much global coverage. Those that are currently outside, with a couple of exceptions, are largely tiny little states or giant states in sub-Saharan Africa, but either way with very minimal biotech capacity. We have, over the last few years, had slow but steady improvement in national implementation. That's not just laws and regulations, but also national biosafety and biosecurity frameworks, and as well as the measures to find out what scientists are at the international level, it, as we've heard, is pretty uncontroversial. There are no states that are allowed to retain these weapons. There's no loopholes for domestic use, and equally, there's a very strong norm that underpins it. Now, we've also heard that the BWC is a little bit of an anomaly when you start looking at WMD regimes. There's no treaty organization to do the operationalization of the regime. The treaty itself is largely aspirational. It has to be over 4 pages. That sets out the aims. In other words, don't make biological weapons. There's very few details there about how you translate that into effective action. We've heard that there was an attempt to go down the more traditional lines of putting in place a treaty organization and developing a verification regime in the 90s. I think that process clearly established that irrespective of that, we need an alternative approach to the broader issue of deliberate disease. There are a number of distinct challenges. I think there's pretty much widespread recognition amongst the scientific community that all of the science and technology we're dealing with here is dual use, that it can also be used to cause harm. We're dealing with a living system. It's complex, it's self-replicating, and only minimally characterized. And that my modern biology is diverse, both in terms of geography, social distribution, and technical distribution. Just think about how many disciplines fall under the life sciences. This brings us to a certain number of implications and realities. Technical verification of compliance is very difficult. There are many actors relevant to different parts of the challenges. There's a need to deal with many different sectors of society, governments, international organizations, industry, academia, et cetera, and perhaps importantly, this is also not a traditional North-South issue. This is not, at the international level, a question of developed versus developing countries, but it offers some unique opportunities to break out of that dynamic. And I think what we've learned from those challenges is that we need a really network-based approach. What we've been doing recently is incredibly decentralized. There is no international organization in which all of the resources you need to implement the treaty sit. They're dispersed over a large number of actors. Those resources are distributed. Different actors play different roles. Most of them spend 99% of their time doing things completely unrelated to biological weapons. And finally, there are implications here for the type of support you need when you're dealing with a network as opposed to an organization. Our role is very much facilitation as opposed to operization. Bring it back down to global health security. BWC deals with the application of the life sciences to deliberately cause harm. Deliberate disease is still disease, and there are many things that dealing with deliberate disease has in common with dealing with accidental or natural outbreaks. It's the risk spectrum we've heard about. Now, there clearly are some things that you can do that address the entire spectrum. Disease surveillance is perhaps the strongest example. And the idea that we can work on that entire spectrum is what I think underpins the concepts of health security. And that efforts to deal with deliberate disease should, for the most part, reinforce and support efforts to deal with health and safety. The natural disease burden is clearly larger at a global level than that caused by accidental events, and certainly larger in recent years over that caused by deliberately instigated events. Security resources can and should bring added value to these efforts. But that approach, as we heard from Dr. Petro just now, only takes you so far. There are some things that health and safety capacity cannot do with regards to deliberate disease. So some dedicated capacity is necessary. We have in place a regime to deal with safety issues, so it's not too much of a stretch to have one to deal with security issues. And the international level, that's pretty much what the convention does. We've heard that recently we've been having annual meetings. Next year we have a big review conference that will look back at what we've been doing over the last 5 or 10 years and make decisions about what we'll do over the next 5 to 10 years. Those two sets of meetings that we've had every year have been to gather information on a set list of topics and then to give states the opportunity to think about what they're going to do about it. Perhaps of most interest to this audience is the topic from last year and the topic from this year. Last year we dealt with dealing with disease irrespective of cause, and this year we're dealing with capacity to respond to an allegation of use or deliberate disease event. And I think that very much is health security in practice, both sides of the coin. And I think one of the best examples of how health security efforts can feed into that process are a set of meetings that have been co-sponsored by the US government through the State Department before each of the meetings of experts last year and this year, focusing on the international health regulations and how building capacity there can bring benefits to the security community, and equally how resources that the security community currently has can help build capacity under the international health regulations. Recent BWC meetings have produced both tangible and intangible outputs. Some of the tangible ones have been common understandings. Quite rare for an international setting, we've not been negotiating anything. We've been looking for areas where states already agree, and I can tell you that's a lot more easier to do. And it's kind of been surprising, not only the number, but also the range of things that states actually agree on under the broad banner of health security. Some of the intangible benefits have been through some of the networking activities themselves, and we've actually had anecdotes of countries in the world where health and security domestic communities have met for the first time, having travelled all the way to Geneva to do it. I'm not suggesting that's the most efficient model, but at least it's a benefit at some point. So finally, some personal observations on health security. It's based upon what I've seen in Geneva. I think at the international level, certainly in relation to the BWC, there is still some confusion on what health security is. For example, last year a reference to health security was removed from our common understandings because one country particularly ardently didn't understand, or at least said there was no internationally recognized definition of what the concept of health security was. So therefore, that's perhaps the first thing on a need list, might be a better understanding at the international level. And that, I think, will be important to harmonize across health, safety, and security communities. I think also it's fair to say that there's a perception out there that the current US policy is really quite different from that one of the previous administration. And there's a bit of incredulity out there that you actually really want to spend your money improving their disease surveillance and capacity and health capacity. Beyond that, in some quarters, there's still some suspicion out there over the motives and aims. Where's the catch? Where's the hidden motives? And that, in turn, might have some impact on the uptake around the globe on this concept. But the message that I would then deliver to this audience is that there is a real need to stick with it. The message of continuity, or the continuity of the message, is very, very important. And I think it's worth thinking about how that message will be continued after the next change or the next two changes in the White House. I think one of the nice things of knowing you're going to have different presidents in the future is that you do need to plan ahead for continuity. And I think you can demonstrate in practice that there is no hidden agenda here, and you will need to let the world, rest of the world, catch up with your thinking in this area. And I think that's not necessarily something that you can force. It's best to let them come to this conclusion by themselves, but you can certainly provide them with a range of opportunities to do that. And I think the meetings that I mentioned held before meetings with experts in Geneva are an excellent example about how you can do that. Gigi also asked me to just focus a little bit on opportunities for action in the BWC regime. So most obviously is the review conference next year in December and the preparatory committee probably in April. Those are high-level formal international meetings. There are opportunities there to push global health security concepts through official national statements, through working papers and background information, and perhaps more interestingly through side events that offer a much more interactive setting. There's also the next intersessional process, assuming we're going to have one. You can build in concepts of global health security into that. The agenda is still being set. The decision will be taken at the review conference. There's the future of my own unit, the implementation support unit. That again will be decided at the review conference next year. If this is an area that you're interested in having us work more actively in, it might be worth having some specific language in our mandate to do that. It would be remiss of me not to flag the need for resources to do that, of course, but I'll leave that one as it is. Finally, the part that sort of often slips off the table is the regional and national events. There is increasing number and distribution of events held around the world, whether it's for implementation of the treaty, whether it's on biosafety and biosecurity, whether it's science and technology. This is my 27th meeting of the year. I've already got major international travels for the planned once a month for the next 6 months of last year, so there's certainly no lack of opportunity there. I think those would provide interesting forums to sell the concept and to build the sort of consensus and support you'll need to actually have that change in the international dialogue. And I think finally the last thing that I would put on the table is that it would probably help to have the message repeated of the desirability of health and security communities working together. We've come a heck of a long way in the last 18 months and 2 years, but I think there are many more opportunities out there, and personally I'd like to see that continue over the future. So that would be my comments.
Thank you very much.
Well, thank you. This is going to be a little more ad hoc than I had hoped. Ben made several of the points I was hoping to make. Piers didn't make some of the points I thought he was going to. So certainly the paragraph that says Piers has done an excellent job of covering point X. Little bit of freelancing here at this point. But first, a quick mention. Piers raised the question of a definition of health security. And this came up at a meeting I was at about a month ago, where we quickly decided that that got very messy very quickly, that there was this area that sort of everybody agreed was pretty clearly health security, but it's the boundary conditions that are problematic. At what point have you moved over to the point where it's just health? What point have you hit the point where you say, well, it's really just security? I'm not sure that we need to get into a protracted exercise of trying to define, but we certainly need to socialize the concept further. I think that's the core point. Speaking of negotiations, I don't want to get into a protracted 163-nation negotiation to develop a definition of health security is not one. You mentioned that people see a change in our approach, and I think that's something we're pleased to hear. You know, the national strategy, as Ben pointed out, promoting global health security is, you know, the first of the seven objectives. We also talked very specifically about that when Department of State Undersecretary Ellen Tauscher gave her address last year at the BWC meeting of states parties as something where we saw a role for the BWC. And you know, from our perspective, a lot of what we're talking about here are things that really, first and foremost, are WHO and health side issues, but where we have a concern. For example, in the event of a response to a biological attack, you do need things other than what you need for a basic public health response. But if you don't have the public health response in place, if you don't have the disease surveillance and the other measures, you have a problem, and you haven't taken the first step. So we see it as an important role, but a supporting role. Now, Piers mentioned a little bit about the intersessional program, which is our little term of art. We had a meeting, a review conference. We hold those every 5 years, need them or not. This was in 2006. And we set out a set of topics, discrete topics, for each year that would be discussed. The idea is you bring together experts for a week to discuss the topic. You then do it again at a more political level to try and see what commonalities you can find. And for the last 2 years of this intersessional, it's been health security topics. As Pierce said, disease surveillance and capacity building for disease surveillance and response. And then, more specifically this year, the focused question of response to alleged use. Now, the interesting thing there is that you bring together a much wider community than we used to get in the old days. These meetings now involve delegations that include people from the public health sector, from the law enforcement community, from a much wider range of parts of governments than we've seen before. And many of them are meeting with their counterparts in many cases for the first time. And so this is an exchange. People basically are briefing on things they're doing, describing issues they're having. But it's actually extremely productive in terms of bringing those people together. Last year, 2009, the week before the experts meeting, the World Health Organization had a one-day meeting, invited IHR focal points, national focal points, and also BWC experts from countries to basically educate them about the international health regulations. This year, they did, in fact, what we call a side event during the day, during the week of our meeting, talking more specifically through a specific Annex 2. Is it Annex 2? Yeah. Yes. I know my IHR is at least that much. Exercise. So what we're seeing is these bridges between the health community and the security community, and I want to underscore that. In 2009, this was in many cases for the security people, the first time they'd ever heard of the international health regulations. People from the public health side know it well, but it was quite novel for a number of the people in these rooms. It was also the first exposure of a number of the health community people to the Biological Weapons Convention. And it was sort of a novel idea to them that there was, you know, a role here, that this was relevant to them. So I think those are very big changes. And I think they're particularly important because there's a, between the Biological Weapons Convention and the international health regulations, some very important complementarity. For example, under the Biological Weapons Convention, under Article 7, we have an obligation to assist each other in the event of a biological weapons attack. Well and good, but in the event of an attack, you may not know that you've been attacked for some time. The case of the Rajneeshis in Oregon is quite instructive in that regard. Well, under Article 44 of the IHRs, there is a common undertaking to work to cooperate in the detection and response of public health events of international concern. Both treaties have provisions talking about cooperation for capacity building and information exchange. So given the fact that this is part of this broader threat that Ben, I think, did a very nice job of contextualizing, the fact that we've got treaties that or agreements that have that degree of overlap and can be integrated. They're separate instruments, but we can think about how they synergize, I think is an extremely important thing. Now, these meetings, as Piers mentioned, what they're trying to do is record areas of commonality, not negotiate bright new ideas. So there's sometimes the question, well, what good is this? Does it actually do anything? And I would actually argue that the dialogue has been the most important thing, the exchange of ideas. And it's actually seemed to drive a considerable amount of activity in capitals. It helps to get the idea across of the political importance here. Oh, and it does one other thing. It lets countries that have money meet countries that have needs for which they have programs. So the people from Department of State and DOD's threat reduction programs come along as either as part of our delegation or separately. The people from the Canadian Global Partnership Program come, and this is a fantastic opportunity for them to make links, make connections with people, and to also tie in the idea that when we're assisting countries with disease surveillance, when we're assisting with capacity building, we're also reinforcing the norms embodied in the BWC. But we're going into this review conference, it's a year away, which is actually a really short time in multilateral terms. And so now we have an opportunity to sort of redefine what exactly we want out of the BWC in this area. We know there are some things we want to do. Ben did a very able job of outlining sort of the big picture. But in this particular area, this is a great way to implement, you know, working through the BWC and in the BWC format or forum to talk about health security issues is, among other things, a great way to deal with our obligations under Article 10 of that convention, which has to do with international cooperation and exchange. Here we are talking about things that are of common interest, where we can really help each other. And it takes some of the politics out of the room and lets us focus on real problems and actually make real progress on some of those problems. That's great. And we think there's an important role here. But it does raise the question, if we want to go beyond where we are now, and yet we recognize that we don't have the lead on issues like disease surveillance, how do we best support work going on in the WHO and in other venues? Is it political statements? Is it information exchange, as we've been doing? Is it other things? That's an area where we're continuing to discuss amongst ourselves with others. We welcome other other people's ideas, because in order to get this right, given the kind of construct we have in the BWC, it's got to be something that makes sense to a large range of people. But we would like to continue to support the work that's being done in the health community and build this integration that, as Piers said, I think has really come a long way in the last 18 months. I think there's further to go, but I think it is happening. Thank you.
Thanks, Gigi. First, I just want to thank Tom and his team for inviting me. Very nice to be here. And there's actually a number of staff from WHO here, including Ginel Rodier, who will be talking later on, but Ginel is really one of the architects of the IHR, so I think it'll be good to have him speaking. So, like everybody, I think probably the more interesting part of the discussion is going to be on the questions, and so I just want to make some, I think, overarching comments, and really what I wanted to try to do is to put a lot of this discussion in context, because I think that there is still a broader context beyond the security and health security issues. I think that at the global level, one thing which is very clear is that the opportunities for public health are now greater than they were in the past. There are simply opportunities which just were not there not so long ago. And while the details on a lot of these issues are really complex, the basic case is fairly simple. If you listen to different people, both in the health sector as well as in the political sector, you now see that the linkages between health, economics, health and development, health and foreign policy are almost taken for granted. I mean, there's a great confluence and something that we hadn't seen in the past. And so, for example, if you look at the Millennium Development Goals, this is really one of the best manifestations of this confluence of different sectors and different perspectives coming together. When you ask yourself, you know, why is this true now, I think that there are probably a number of different answers. But for me, probably the most compelling perspective is that we have adopted this perspective because we need it. If we're going to move ahead, this is probably the only perspective that we can really take at this point. And the reason for that is that if you look at some of the issues that are being addressed, these are things like climate change, emerging infectious diseases, development in terms of health, the sheer technical complexity of dealing with these issues and the scope of them is now, it's really quite vast. And when you take that and you overlay it with the issues being driven by globalization, the demographic shifts going on around the world, the movement towards urbanization in all countries, and you look at the economic shifts in power centers and also the the economic severities being dealt with now, the realities of the now, it is really a very complex mix of things. And what that means is that in this kind of situation, you really can't afford to look at health simply as health. The converse of that is that if you are working in these other areas, you really can't be working in these other areas without taking health and good health as part of an important part of that agenda. And it's a two-sided story to this. And so, anyways, this is an evolution which is really moving quite fast, but I think it's one of the realities at the global center. So this confluence of these kinds of interests is really creating what I think of as genuinely new opportunities that are really welcome. But it also introduces a level of confusion which is there, and also some dangers which are there. And I think it's important to be equally clear about those things. So, for example, if we talk about what are the potential dangers for this situation, well, simply there are more niches, more perspective, more players on the global scene. And so one of the dangers, of course, is fragmentation of efforts. And so that you can take what would have been simpler to address, and it is now more complex, and in a certain way, a reason for not making progress. Another thing, which is an issue which was raised by Piers, is that when situations become very complex, when countries do not quite understand what is going on, then there is always the danger that there's a suspicion of hidden agendas, the danger of distrust. And this is part and parcel of the package, and this is one of the realities that we have to acknowledge and come to grips with. So I think that this evolving relationship between the security sector and public health is really a good example of this overall situation. It's one part of it. It takes place in other parts of the discussion, but this is a good one to look at. So on the one hand, I think it is fair to say that global health security has long been and continues to be a major priority for WHO. It's very clear to us that the challenges raised by certain kinds of events are not going to disappear. These kinds of events are going to occur in the future, and that we have to be ready to deal with them and deal with them better than we have in the past. And I think that this is the challenge of that, especially in the post-pandemic period, are quite clear. And I think that, for example, how we move to strengthen global communications, the access to information, the access to materials, how we move on strengthening national capacities. These are some of the key things which are clear in the post-pandemic period, and dealing with them is more critical than ever. At the same time, as was mentioned both by Chris and by Piers, I think that the issue of what exactly is global health security remains an alive issue. If you look at some of the documents going back to the 1990s, what you see is that, for example, from the UNDP, a quite seminal and important report coming out in 94 discussing about human security. And if you go forward from that time, you'll see that there are a number of discussions, a number of articles, resolutions by different bodies going over this area. But what it does is it reflects different perspectives, different questions about what is this area, what does it actually mean, what is its relationship to a number of other important concepts like security, human security, development, and so on. And in this sort of milieu, and actually one of the more recent documents that you can look at are some of the documents coming out of the regional committee meetings by PAHO in Washington, again, in which you see a quite in-depth discussion about these issues. And so what this really means is that there is still a question of what is the position of something like global health security in relation to development, human development, security, and so on. And again, depending on your perspective, you see it one way or the other. But it is something which, again, has to be addressed in some ways. But I agree with my colleagues here that sort of addressing this as a definitional issue is really a kind of dead-end approach. It really is not. It's perhaps necessary, but that's not the game. So I think that if we then look at the issues related to the international health regulations and the and the convention on the CBW, again, what we can now begin to see is that this is really one part of a larger discussion. You know, the security discussions themselves are part of a larger discussion. But here again, we're talking about something which fits into a broader context. Now, the international health regulations, as Gigi went over, represent what is probably a unique framework in global public health. The purpose of this, again, of this framework is, you know, comes down to a couple of different issues. One of the philosophical changes in going to the new international health regulations is a much more active stance in public health. Again, rather than try to stop things at your borders, try to prevent diseases from coming in, taking a much more active perspective that things can be addressed early in the origin as they develop, trying to stop them, trying to detect them, trying to respond to them as early as possible. A second aspect of it, and one which is really highlighted by the pandemic, I think, is the whole issue of access to information, increasing the flow of communications is a critical part of the international health regulations. And then the third part of it, and one which is receiving a lot of attention, especially post-pandemic, is the notion that the IHR are themselves a reason, but perhaps more importantly, they are a vehicle for strengthening core capacities in countries. And so you have these different aspects to the international health regulations, but again, what it is clearly post-pandemic is it's emerged as a central part of the framework for dealing with these large global events. It's an essential thing, and I think this has really been cemented by the pandemic. So I think that when we look again at the two things, the IHR and the BWC, that you can see that there is a large potential area of overlap in them. In fact, they are very similar in certain respects, and they highlight the needs for certain things. But I think especially if we look at things like surveillance and capacity building, these are both very prominent in the thinking behind both of the treaties. However, again, I want to point out that the discussion about how we move forward on this is really a quite deliberative discussion. And the sensitivity and potential risks, I think, are clear. And again, but I just want to make sure that this is understood. I think that on the one hand, for public health and global public health, the engagement by the security sector is a very welcome development. Again, it helps reflect the overarching reality of what we're dealing with at the global health level. The potential support from the security sector in many ways for supporting public health, I think, is very real, and I think, again, very welcome. On the other hand, it is equally as clear and as true that public health and global public health really can't be perceived as losing its traditional focus. Its traditional focus is not national security. Its traditional focus really looks at human development, equity, fairness, health, these sorts of issues. And so if it is perceived as becoming an instrument of security concerns or of national policy, then it really is in danger of being perceived as having deviated and moved away from where its inherent strength and its inherent mandate lies. So I think this is really the issue in a nutshell. So on the one hand, at WHO, it is a very strong tenet of belief that human development, the concepts of equity and fairness, the concepts that countries and communities and individuals have to have the capacity to act, and that ability and that capacity to act is at the heart of what constitutes health, is a very strong part of the institution, I think a strong part of global public health. At the same time, at WHO, we also recognize that while all diseases cause adverse health effects, there are a certain group of diseases, of conditions and events, which in addition to that, really have the ability to rock society. It has the ability to destabilize, it has the ability to really adversely affect the functioning of countries and of communities like that, and that addressing those as part of global health security is also an important facet. So I think that, you know, for me personally, I certainly don't see these as opposing tendencies. The real issue is that we have a balance of issues here. We have to be very careful to balance them right, because I think the issue is not what you get right over the next few days or few years, but what you get right over the long span. That's really what we're working towards. And so I think that, again, what it really comes down to is that the key issue here is striking what's the right balance, what is the complement of approaches and philosophies. So let me stop there. Thanks, Gigi.
Thank you all very much for your remarks. I'm going to ask a few questions to get us started. Please feel free to address each other. And I think there will be microphones. And just when you ask a question, just come up to the microphone and state your name, your affiliation, and please, your question should be in the form of a question. So let me get this started. You've all touched on the balance between health and security and the need to get it right, and that there are common problems that we're trying to solve, and the necessity of balancing this. But I'd like you to say a little more about how you're going to manage this. How big of a problem is this balance? And as a quick follow-up, we often hear about the concerns that the health side has on the interjection of security, but is there any resistance on the security side to having health become much more of a part of the agenda? So whoever wants to start.
I'll take the easy part of the last question, that I don't see any evidence of any problems being thrown up by health becoming involved, quite the opposite. Mm-hmm. In particular in sub-Saharan Africa, where traditionally we've had an uphill struggle to actually get states interested in this, taking the spectrum of biological risks as a basis and a way to introduce the topic has actually mean countries have suddenly gone, oh wait, what, this actually has something to do with us. So it's actually been an incredibly empowering tool. Just even without the direct involvement of sitting both communities down, just the intellectual framework behind it has been incredibly important.
Okay, but what about the management of the not getting the balance wrong in the countries that might feel that that security is involved too much in health? How is that problem to be managed?
How
big a problem is it?
I'm not sure. It's an easy problem to put a size on. What I can tell you is it's a durable problem. It's been there for a long time. This isn't something new. Certainly, it was part of the discussions around the end to the ad hoc group negotiations in the 1990s under the BWC, is what role the WHO might fill in the absence of a treaty organization to deal with deliberate disease. And extended off that ISAC. I mean, another practical example of these communities working together over quite a long time, BWC had no implementation support unit at that point in time, but under the BWC flag, I sat in the last 3 years of negotiations of the international health regulations, saw that firsthand, absolutely fully appraised of the sensitivities there, the countries that feel that particularly strongly. I think it's interesting the role of certain individuals in stating those opinions. Some of those individuals are no longer working at the international level in that certain area, so maybe that reduces the complexity in some ways. But I'm sure inherently it's still there. I think it's one of those situations where transparency, dialogue, keep going at this. I mean, my personal view is it's not something we should shy away from. It's something that we should be seen to be addressing, so that everybody, particularly those that are very conscious of those sensitivities, have their opportunity to express their opinions, that they don't feel that something is being done outside of their control. You know, it should be worked on basic democratic principles. If people don't want this nexus to work, give them the opportunity to say that and why.
Actually raised a couple of really good questions there. In terms of, is there ever any pushback on the security side? There actually is, mostly in my experience from a few European governments and academics. There's been a certain strain of rhetoric in the last year about the importance of returning to, quote, the core mission of the BWC, with the idea that this disease surveillance stuff in particular is really a bit soft. It's, you know, what about the bad guys here? And I can, at some level, understand that. It's not sort of the thing that the people who are coming from the long-term arms control or non-proliferation community are used to thinking about. But if you look at the range of problems we face, prevention is an important approach, and we should try to prevent biological attacks, whether by states or non-state actors. But the reality is that we can't spot everything every time, so we need a public health system that can detect and respond to significant disease outbreaks, and we need it not just in the U.S., but we need it elsewhere. So from the security standpoint, it makes excellent sense, even in a fairly narrow, focused way. But there is this tension, and it does need to be managed, and people need to be educated to some extent. Conversely, when you say, well, is there a problem from the health side? Dr. Fukuda can probably provide much more insight into that. But it was quite interesting to me, the two conferences we held this summer. We had representatives from about 40 different countries and all around the world. And what we found was, along with people largely from the security side in the US, talking about the various assistance programs that they had and how those could be used to reinforce health capacity and specifically disease surveillance capacity and IHR implementation. And what we found was a tremendous degree of pragmatism. If there are not strange strings attached, if the projects and the funding and the activities meet my government's and my country's needs, okay. I think that last is the important point. One of the things that our threat reduction programs certainly learned over the years and have gotten better and better about is that if you want sustainability, the first test of sustainability is, does the program or activity you've put in place actually meet local needs rather than the needs of somebody in Washington? If you don't have that, you're not going to have sustainability. There are other challenges after that, but that's the first step. And I think we've made significant strides in terms of our ability to do that. So I find it interesting. On both sides, I sit there and say, well, yes, there is an issue. The biggest issue seems to be with NGOs and academics in the developed world rather than the folks who really need the assistance, who are much more practical and pragmatic about it. Sorry if I sound anti-intellectual and anti-elitist. I'm not actually running for office.
Would you like to remark on this?
Sure. Well, to answer the one question, yes, I think it's a significant issue. I mean, again, I think that if we step away from the immediate issue at hand and sort of look a little bit more broadly, you know, perhaps the single most difficult thing at the international level, and maybe in all negotiations, is the issue of trust. It is an extremely difficult concept to work around, but it is probably the single most important element in negotiations and discussions. And here, this is what we're talking about. And I think that when you hear phrases like north, south, developing, developed, what it really gets at is this issue of trust. It doesn't really get at groups of countries, but, you know, again, that there are perspectives and the inherent separation for those things, of course, are many different things, but again, trust is part of that. And you see this dynamic playing out in a number of different fora right now. So, for example, we are involved in this big issue about negotiating over the sharing of viruses and of benefits. Recently in Nagoya, there was a conclusion of the Convention on Biological Diversity, which again addressed this from a different perspective, from the environmental perspective, but again really tackling the same issues. And what you see there are that what is most difficult in these negotiations is this idea of equity and fairness and trust. And I think that some of the points brought out both by Chris and by Piers are necessary. You know, for example, the degree to which transparency is possible, you know, this really has to be pushed as much as possible. But the proof of the pudding for most countries is at the end of these negotiations, at the end of these conventions, did it actually help us or didn't it help us? And I think here this whole issue of benefits really encapsulates what is again the practical concern. You know, things go on, we're not quite sure about all of the underpinnings of it, but in the end, was there a net benefit for the country or was there not a net benefit? And I think that it's that demonstration which I think is the critical component. And again, until you actually are in the position to show that something can deliver, you know, you can't show that it delivers, but getting there again has, you know, requires that sort of demonstration. It's a little bit of a chicken and egg situation. Mm-hmm. But again, underpinning it is this issue of can I trust what is being said, what is being done, and so on.
So that leads into the, go ahead.
Actually, if I just follow up on that, I think the trust point is very important. And when you work internationally, you have cultural and linguistic differences to begin with. When you're also working cross-sectorally, when, for example, DOD is assisting people in the health community, you've got a different kind of a language and cultural barrier there. And it's real. I say that without any denigration to either side. What I was struck by, though, is the degree to which people have come to understand that and are starting to work past it in terms of really working on the communication and building the understanding and trust so that there is not as much of a knee-jerk reaction as I would have expected, quite frankly. But I think the point Dr. Fukuda made about the importance of transparency and trust is absolutely essential, and there are additional challenges when you're cutting across sectors.
So what can, this leads to my question, next question, what can the BWC, for example, do to either assuage those concerns or to actually show the proof in the pudding that, you know, that health security can be delivered?
What do I have to, feeling that all eyes are on me at this point in time? I know from some of our discussions with our colleagues at WHO on this that there is a little feeling of jadedness here. There's been a long discussion. These miraculous benefits that the security community was going to provide to the health community from a more collective role, even when we're dealing with hardcore bioterrorism issues, there was a sense that, where is this? When are we finally going to see some results? But I think if you start looking at, as case studies, what the threat reduction programs have been doing around the world, those are tangible benefits. That is security money being spent increasingly on putting in place core disease capacity. Now, that's not done through the BWC. It's nothing that the BWC can take credit for. But as Chris mentioned, we've certainly seen over the last 2 years our meetings becoming a forum for those sorts of partnerships to fall into place. It's a great place for potential donors to come and meet potential partners. And so I think they are out there. I could go away and do some research and come back with numbers and figures, but beyond that, I could probably come up with some anecdotes, but that's about it.
Well, I don't know if these are the academics that that you were referring to, Chris, but I read a paper from Feldbaum and colleagues at the London School of Tropical Medicine that suggested that treating global health issues as security threats will focus attention disproportionately on those developing countries that are also of strategic national security interest. So my question is, you know, how does this add to the cynicism? Is this something that, you know, can be dealt with at all? Is this something that is not happening?
Well, I guess I would say that's absolutely always a risk. You know, when you have money that is fulfilling a shared goal, those that have a national security perspective and those that are from a health perspective, is it going to cover the full area that both groups would like addressed? Are the resources going to be applied in the areas that both would find to be the top priorities? And the answer is probably not always. Now, I don't think we have a case of the tail wagging the dog. If you look at the amount of money going into, for example, the Global Health Initiative, and so much of that is going in various ways to health system strengthening, that I think we're safe from the charge that the security dollars are driving what we're doing internationally. And I think we have been working very hard over the last couple years, and especially since the development of the national strategy, to develop methods of coordinating internally to try and make sure that both the health and security sectors have a common vision and are working together rather than working in ways that are at best sort of side by side, not harming each other, and at worst undercutting each other. So I think in theory it is absolutely a concern. In practice, I think we're mindful of that concern and working very hard to ensure that that's not what happens. Thank
you. I think you can also see practical examples of this. Perhaps building new reference collection labs in the former Soviet Union doesn't meet globally health threats. However, building diagnostic labs in sub-Saharan Africa clearly is a more balanced approach. So when you see CTR funding, for example, in work in Kenya, in Uganda, in Nigeria, and that's new money, those are things that wouldn't happen if the security community wasn't there. Then I think, you know, Chris's last comment that the difference between theory and practice is perhaps important to remember.
Although again, I think I want to, maybe put a little caveat here, because I think that from the health perspective, again, one of the concerns with the economic downturn is that there's been much discussion about where development dollars will go besides decreasing. And the sense is that some of the funding may go towards countries or regions which are unstable, and so pulling money out of public health and out of development. And so again, it does have the potential for, again, saying that there are different interests on different sides, and again, if you take as a tenet that public health has to move in all areas, in all regions, in all countries again, but it's being selectively moved towards some areas, being pulled out for certain reasons, again, there is an unease and a tension there. And so I think that is simply part of the reality.
And I think there are some very promising notes on that. I mean, I was at a meeting last week about the G8 Global Partnership on Weapons of Mass Destruction. One of the messages that came out of that is that one of the major concerns is agreeing to the next one relates to exactly that issue. Is this the time to be announcing major new spending on security issues when there are genuine threats that countries are facing? So it's noting that, for example, this year's Global Partnership meeting agreed to $10 billion on commercial work, on cooperative work on vaccines and strengthening health issues, but didn't agree to anything on Global Partnership side. So I would see that as a very positive note that those issues are being recognized and are being addressed, at least amongst 8 countries.
Yeah, and I'd also comment that the point that Dr. Fukuda made is, you know, it's a fair concern. It's sort of a higher level of abstraction where we're talking about the security community in a much broader sense when we get to the question of how best to allocate aid dollars overall. And you know, one of the factors there is going to be what are the international security implications? What can we do to stabilize areas that we feel are heading towards instability? Fortunately, that one's way above my pay grade, and I really don't have to worry about it on a day-to-day basis. So I was focusing on at a much more concrete level in terms of our threat reduction activities and that sort of investment. But the theological debate, and I think that's the right term for it, about how and why to invest aid dollars is not going to be resolved in my lifetime, but it goes back and forth.
Like to entertain some questions from the audience. You've been very patient.
Hi, Colonel Rondo from Smallpox Security. My question is for Piers. You mentioned in your remarks that that countries are coming together and they're meeting often without the under the auspices of the WHO in Geneva. Could you give are there any examples that stand out in particular? And what are these countries? How do they come together? And what do they accomplish? And how is that going to serve?
I think that The work done by the cooperative threat reduction programs are the strongest examples of that. But at a more practical level, it's quite often, as various comments this morning have said, it's about communities meeting and finding shared interests. Some of the things that stood out in particular for me is in addition to the meetings that both Chris and myself and various others have mentioned this morning, that on the international health regulations, one run by IHR, part of WHO, the other run by, I think we actually co-sponsored the second one as well. So what they really did is to bring folks together that hadn't met, that hadn't considered that there were issues there. And that at a practical level is not something that directly now will have benefits for the BWC. It's not going to influence our review conference next year. But hopefully, you know, in 10 years' time, these communities working together will reduce some of the tensions there, will provide opportunities to work together. And I think the last thing to say is that one of the standout presentations that I've seen recently is the joint presentation by the FBI and CDC, who clearly had a shared language, they had a shared objective, they were comfortable with each other's roles, they recognized that there were problems, there were boundaries, and that they had to find a way with working together. And the fact that they were able to do that on a national level gives me hope that we can do that internationally.
I have a question about the role of civil society, the people in this audience. What is it that groups or individuals should be doing to help implement the IHRs and BWC?
But not the IHRs.
Mm-hmm.
In the BWC context, there are a couple of things. One, of course, is you can always send a self-addressed stamp envelope, maybe some money.
Is this to be written out in cash? Is that the...
Just make it out to Piers. He'll take care of it. We're very much interested in civil society as part of the ongoing dialogue in the BWC, not just in the health sphere, but in the realm of science and technology, professional responsibility in the life sciences. The problem of deliberate use of disease is one where certain aspects of the threat are so distributed. Treaties by themselves won't solve the problem. Laws by themselves won't solve the problem. Regulations like the select agent regulations will help but won't solve the problem. You've also got to actually enlist the community. Dialogue with stakeholders is another one of the seven priorities in the national strategy for exactly that reason. We need to enlist the community as a whole and raise awareness. So what are the ways in which people can do that, should they choose to? One, if you go to the ISU website, which is UNOG, U-N-O-G, www.unog.ch, and then find the disarmament link and the BWC one in the corner, there is actually information about how one goes about seeking to attend a meeting as an observer. We do recognize NGOs as observers, academics. There are a variety of different categories. So there's an opportunity to actually attend meetings and, you don't actually get to speak by and large, but on the other hand, the real conversations take place in the coffee lounge. So that's your chance to really influence people. And there are a whole series of side events that occupy every morning and every lunch hour. The other thing to think about doing is if you have views on health security or any other aspect of what your government or the international community writ large is doing in the BWC context, you write a paper, send an email, talk to the people in the US government, send something to the ISU, and maybe they'll post it on their website. I don't know exactly what the rules are for screening unsolicited submissions.
It's the cash envelope again.
I think the key point I'd make there is if you want to do anything other than just make noise, you need to pick your audience, you need to pick your argument, and you need to move early. Papers that come out or proposals that come up a month or so before the review conference are essentially dead in the water, because people will get there at the meeting and say, I haven't had time to review it, I have no instructions from capital, my hands are tied. So you've just wasted however much time you've spent on that little project. If you want to influence the views of governments, that is a slow process, especially when you're trying to get a whole bunch of them to agree on something. So there is a role for civil society, but the first rule is start early. Thank you.
This is a really good question. This is a very difficult question, too. I think that one of the big challenges for international organizations as well as for governments is how to incorporate the input from, you know, the so-called civil society. It is clear that civil society is a major player in shaping opinion, in driving issues, in raising issues, and going where maybe government discussions don't really want to go to. They play a very important role in I think, the overall intellectual discourse and actually the political actions taken. And I think that, again, when you look at the past pandemic, you see that the effects of things, you know, the so-called social media, which really, you know, reflects a great deal of the actions of NGOs and of civil society, were critical in shaping much of the communication issues related to that and even beyond that. And I think that for organizations like WHO, it does pose an issue of how do you sort of incorporate this kind of input. On the one hand, there are NGOs with whom we are in so-called official relations, and so there's a process by which they are recognized. There's a much larger group of NGOs who are not in official relations. The WHO is inherently an organization of member states, and so it is for member states, it is run by member states, it is not run for other entities. And so again, how do you sort of incorporate the other entities into that kind of governing structures? There have been suggestions that perhaps, you know, the work of the at the World Health Assembly is done in these so-called committees, usually Committee A and Committee B. There has been discussion that perhaps there ought to be another committee which begins to incorporate this in other ways. And so, again, it is an issue for countries in terms of their governance and in terms of how they address these issues both in the international fora as well as themselves. And so, yes, I think very important. How to go forward with it, I think, is not completely answered yet. Mm-hmm.
I've got some comments as well,
sure.
If that's all right. I think if I gave you my usual presentation, there's a slide in that that has a pyramid, that has a treaty sitting on the top, has the regime sitting under that, has the activities of states sitting under that, and the whole thing is built on a community base. And it's important to remember that when we're talking about biology today, modern biology is not largely driven by states. It's increasingly outside of the hands of business. It's no longer the pharmaceutical companies that are doing the really interesting stuff. It's in the hands of academia, it's in the hands of the startup companies, and it's in the hands of the biotech companies, whose main aim, by the way, is to get bought up by a pharma company. So increasingly, if we're trying to stay relevant, we have to find ways to dealing with that. And that's why I think one of the big things that shifted in the BWC in the last couple of years is it's much more community-based. And what do I mean by community? Well, I think key parts of that community is the industry, private sector. It's great, I can see in the room both Terry Taylor from the International Council for Life Sciences, who has been instrumental in bringing some of the private companies to Geneva. I can also see Rafael de la Rata over there from the Partnership for Global Security, and we'll put in a free plug for him for his biosecurity event on the biotech industry organizations meeting next year. We've had a lot of interest from the biosafety associations. I've got an article on the BWC in the current issue of Applied Biosafety, the journal of the American Biosafety Association, but we've also worked quite closely with the Asia Pacific Biosafety Association, the African Biosafety Association, the Biosafety Association for Central Asia and the Caucasus. We'll be at the International Federation of Biosafety Associations meeting next year. the practicing biologist, Jo Husbands, is in the room somewhere. She's just finished organizing a meeting in Beijing, co-hosted by the Internet Academy Panel on International Issues, which is the umbrella organization for national academies, co-hosted by the International Union on Biochemistry and Molecular Biology, co-hosted by the International Union of Microbiological Societies. They're practicing biologists. They increasingly have a say in BWC discussions. All of those communities have participated in these annual meetings as guests of the meeting, a new category that was created to give them better access. They make presentations to the formal meeting. They are allowed to make questions and interventions in formal BWC meetings, and their contributions have been included in compendiums and synthesis papers, which have directly influenced the outputs on common understandings. We've also have our traditional friends in think tanks and academics, and they continue to play an incredibly important role through those side events. And the serious answer to the question of what to do with those papers in advance of the review conference next year, we've opened up on the website something called a Think Zone, which is really just a space to put up anything to do with the review conference and the future of BWC and the broader issues that it might need to address. So if you have anything you want to see up there, we're not particularly vetting that. Anything to do with aliens and their role might not make its way up as fast as some of the other stuff, but certainly if there's sensible pieces, no matter how controversial as far as our internal opinion is, it should be posted on there to give everybody a chance to have access to the broadest amount of resources as possible.
Did I answer?
Yes, good morning. My name is Dr. Alex Garz. I'm the Assistant Secretary for the Office of Health Affairs at the Department of Homeland Security. You'll notice two words in that title, health and security, which I think are appropriate for the discussion you're having today. So I think I know a little bit about health security. The other part of my career is as a civil affairs officer with the United States military, and I've worked globally promoting health and health security in a counterinsurgency strategy. So my comments or my questions to you is how far along do you see the discipline of health security as it stands right now? And I will use as an example the Global Health Security Action Group, which is still, I think, dominated by public health entities, which is not altogether wrong. However, I still think it is needed to have more of a security element brought into it. Secondly, involves funding, and that is there seems to be in certain elements a controversy over whether money should be spent on public health or on health security matters, and I do not see them as diametrically opposed. I see them more as congruent with each other. So I'd just like to have your opinions on both of those. Thank you.
Let's go first.
I can deal with one and then leave perhaps the other one. How far along is the concept of health security? I think there's still a long way to go, and I'm not really in a position to comment where you are domestically, but I can certainly say internationally the vast majority of the world is much further behind than you guys are, and I don't think there's anybody that's close to joining the thinking up in the same way, and that's why I think it will be so important over the next couple of years to give opportunities for some people to catch up to this sort of level of thinking. I don't think it's one that will cause particular concerns amongst many security communities in many countries around the world. I think if they can see a way to make their efforts more relevant on a national basis, that is something that as individuals they might be able to get behind.
I guess I would just say that the part of developing the health security concept and developing, more importantly, the collaboration that needs to go with that concept, the easy part is the intellectual bit where you look at it and say, oh, I see, it all fits together in a big sort of cosmic piece, and I can, you know, draw a continuum. I love being able to draw a line and then just say, it's a continuum. it's not a line, it's much more special than that. But, you know, and we can draw pyramids with communities at the base. I like that, community-based pyramids. They really were, if you look at the labor force and the design system. That's the easy part. The hard part is going from that to actual integration and coordination, because the reality is that all of these things take a tremendous amount of time and work, and that means you have people dedicated to all these various bits, pieces, and tasks. And they will all agree that better coordination and integration would be good in principle. The question is, when they're looking at their daily agenda, at what cost? You know, this is really an optimization question. How much of my time is spent working my particular sphere of problems, and how much of it is going to, say, interagency meetings? Sorry, Ben. But no, I mean, this is a real issue. You have to find a balance, and it takes time. And because everybody's got a job to do, and because there are so many players, and this issue of the complexity when you start adding in these additional layers was brought up earlier, it has to sort of gradually evolve over time. You can't do it all at once. And I think we actually have made some pretty impressive progress over the last couple of years. Are things as integrated, as seamless, as tightly coordinated as I would like? No, but it's progress, and I'm very pleased with the progress I'm seeing. Hope that helps.
Yeah, I'm not sure whether I'm addressing the question or the intent of the question, but I think that I don't see health security as a definitional issue. I mean, it's of course a complex definitional issue, but if you look at something which has gone on for almost two decades, what it tells you is what you're dealing with on the top is not what you're dealing with. I mean, this is not a wordsmithing issue. What you're really dealing with is that you have different perspectives, and the perspectives are somewhat different, and that's what you have to grapple with. And I think the solution, for me anyways, oftentimes when I think about issues which are intrinsically complex and it's very hard to deal with them on that level, is to go to a different level. And I think the issue really here in global health security is, what are you going to do? What actions are going to be taken? There are certain actions which can be taken which I think are simply neutral across the entire spectrum. There are things which are wanted, which are valued, which are seen by everybody, as this is where help, where there truly is help and so on. And I think the real issue here is how do you focus the attention on those issues which constitute, I think, moving forward for all parts of the spectrum of that opinion. And I think that's where, you know, there really is a lot of confluence. I think there's a lot of congruence about there's certain things that can be moved on. And I think that, you know, we have to get the language right, we have to get the posturing right, and I think these are all solvable issues, but that's where we have to go, I think, anyways.
Okay, this will be the final question.
P.A. Henderson from the Center for Biosecurity. I think in all of this, there's one issue in one area, which I think is a major impediment, and it's not mentioned. And that is, when you talk about security, you're often talking about intelligence. And on the other side, health. And the security intelligence people are not terribly transparent. Let's put it that way. Forever we encounter restrictions on use of material and information and exchange of information. On the health side, we're much more accustomed to being open, completely open, making things available. And I've seen this to be amazing difficulties with tension. It was with the FBI when I was working at CDC. Now, they tried to kind of work together and go a little better, but the sense I have, it's still a bit of a standoff in terms of just how far do you go in sharing information. I don't know what the answer to that is, but I would pose that as being one of the biggest impediments that you have, both nationally and internationally.
Anyone want to comment?
Well, the one thing I would say is, having talked with my FBI colleagues a time or two, my sense is that it's actually a problem that has two sides, because, of course, if you're dealing with a suspicious event, you want all the data you can get from a law enforcement standpoint, and then there are these various laws and regulations and practices that essentially are there to protect patient confidentiality and personal health information. Now, a lot of the information you need is probably aggregated and abstracted, but not always, especially when you're trying to trace contacts and do a variety of other things. So I think there are frustrations and difficulties on both sides in terms of the information sharing, and I think there always will be. I think what has happened over the last several years doesn't change that fundamental reality, but makes it more manageable, because what has happened is that people like the FBI and CDC have started working together more closely. As individuals get to know each other and understand each other, they start to understand the legal, the regulatory, the practical constraints each is working under. You can't always solve the problem that way, but it makes it a whole lot more likely. It's the trust and understanding bit. It's crucial to international agreements, but also inter-bureaucratic agreements. And I think my sense is that the comfort level has increased between the two communities in terms of their sense that they can work this problem and that it's not an insurmountable issue. But I don't want to put words in anybody's mouth from either organization, because this is something I monitor from the side. But my sense is that there's been progress.
And I think as a concrete example of that, one of the things that struck me most out of the joint presentation was the apparent comfort on both sides in carrying out joint interviews and investigations, where each community is able to participate in, sit in on, say, an interview that might previously been purely epidemiological. 99% of the questions are about dealing with the health issues related to an event, but maybe there's some information there that would be useful for a security response, or maybe there's a question that needs to be asked for a perspective, you know, that can be brought to that interview by having both sides there. I think the only other thing I'd say is that I'm also an optimist, and I think this is where the nature of biology might be of benefit. I think there's a pretty strong understanding, certainly in every meeting I've participated in recently, that when we're talking about trying to manage the risk of misuse to cause harm, that the underlying principle is to enable biology for peaceful use. You know, we can't stop the development of this science. We can't impede the development of this science. Increasingly, it's being advertised as a potential answer for many of the global challenges that we face, and we can't, as a species, afford to impede development. And therefore, that is building in openness and transparency at a technical level that maybe we can learn from. At a practical level, I'm always struck that less focus is not placed on how Interpol deals with this issue. It's really kind of crazy that national police forces, privy to effectively intelligence information, are able to cooperate at the international level. How does country A provide sensitive material to an international organization that it's not comfortable about countries B, C, and D seeing? They have a practical solution. You submit the information, you just tick the boxes you don't want that information passed on to. You can literally say to Interpol, this is the information we have on this case, but we're not comfortable with it being provided to countries B, C, and D. And whilst that at the first glance might not contribute to transparency, what it does provide is a system where country X, who might be friends with both countries A, B, C, and D, can say, hey, we've seen it, and yeah, actually, it's fair enough. You know, there's something here. We're not going to tell you exactly what it is, but you know, we'd put our voice behind it. So there are ways of dealing with it. There are practical examples, and sometimes we just have to think of outside of our comfort zones. You know, we need to search for new solutions from new areas.
I mean, I think on the one hand, you know, I completely agree with the point raised by Dr. Henderson. I mean, these are intrinsically very difficult to see how they come together. On the other hand, I am also an optimist, and the optimistic part of it is that, you know, there are a number of things that we deal with which have intrinsically different perspectives and issues, and we make them work together because we have to make them work together. Again, I think it is not so much a discussion on principles, but it's a very practical discussion about how do we take different perspectives and make it work to address issues which are really greater than either one of the sector can deal by itself. But
Okay, well, thank you so much for a fascinating conversation, and I would like if everyone could join me in thanking our panelists who have answered all the questions.